this is a big problem with many DVR systems because everything is compressed in a way to try to save space. And we have to, uncompress those files and kind of gather the details that we're looking for in specific to, get some information about vehicles, license plates, and facial, and all that type of good stuff. The technique known as frame origin, I just want to mention that, I don't want to get too technical, but I think it's very important because this is where this field is really headed, or is a major part of this field, what we call frame origin. And basically with frame origin, what we do is we take many frames of a video and we kind of stitch them together, or we take pieces of each frame that we think it has the greatest detail and we put them together so that you get a better overall picture. Right. And that is kind of demonstrated here in this picture. Now, many of you probably can't see very clearly because of the projector, the image, and how it's been enhanced. But from a digital forensic point of view, there's a lot of information that we can capture from this image that we can then pass on to investigators that will yield some pretty good results. Similarly, here we have one number. So first we have this image, so this is kind of motion blur, and then we do some kind of frame averaging. We end up with some kind of recognizable number. And if we do what we call a negative image, then we can end up with a even greater chance of detecting that information. So I'm going to jump into a facial comparison because this is probably what most of you guys think of when you think about video enhancement and forensics. So the question is here, we have two suspects, one on the left, one on the right, and we have a question in the middle. So the question is, are they the same? And you can clearly see in the question document, we don't really have much information to give you what you may think of as a facial feature recognition, because the guy has been bent down, he has a hat partially on. And but how do we deal with this, and how do we gather information that will be useful towards an investigation? And the answer to that is that we don't always have to just look at directly the overall image. We can look at certain aspects of the facial features. In this particular case, his ears, because we have a very clear indication of his ears. And as well as, if you notice here, he has some kind of balding or some kind of spot here on his head, which is also another indication of individual features that can help the investigation go along. And in here we use basically the geometry of the ear because we were able to get a very good image of the ear based on the side of the ear, and be able to do a comparison, and then from the image we can determine which one of the two was in fact, it belongs to. So I mentioned earlier some ideas about, it's not always about facial recognition, and here we talk about clothing, shoes, other things within a video that are very useful and very incriminative. And here, for example, we see a suspect and they have on a t-shirt, and we're able to then match up. If we are able to collect a known sample or a sample from an alleged suspect, we can then do a comparison to determine whether or not that it was in fact the same t-shirt that is being used. Now, there is a difference between what we call individual and characteristic type evidence. So, this is not a unique shirt. So they may have other people that may have this type of shirt. But it is definitely another piece or another item of evidence that can help, identify that suspect as the one being, or placing that suspect at the scene of the crime. Similarly, again, another example of here we have the original video. When we zoom in, we're able to identify some of the shapes and the objects on that vest. And when we identify the shapes and the objects, what we also use is the distance between the shapes and the objects. So all of that helps us be able to render a forensically sound opinion as to the likelihood that we have a match between this vest in the picture and the vest that is collected. images, we are able to determine a suspect's height. Or, for example, if there's a firearm use, we may be able to determine the size of the firearm, because we know different firearms, different models have slightly different variations. When we start to get to really small measurements, there is a little error of uncertainty. So, you know, when we report this back, we will see, for example, this guy is 5, can't see clearly, but I think it's 5'11". And it will be plus or minus a fraction of an inch in height. You know, that's how we report it forensically, because there is a little bit of variation that will take place. And this is typically done using some kind of certified or accredited scale that we will then take the picture in the same position and then do the calibration with that. Once again, is this object straight on a truck or is it skewed? We can able to very easily determine that in fact that these beams are actually leaning on a truck. So this was actually for some beams that went over on a highway and caused some lives to be lost. So the question was these beams strapped down properly? Was it safe to carry? And we are able to give some information based on some footage of what really transpired. Alright, so in conclusion, what I want to say is that you may ask me, well, how does all this relate to increased efficiency within a police or law enforcement agency? And what I want to say here is it helps focus your investigation and ultimately will help improve your efficiency by focusing your investigation, by helping reduce the amount of time that investigation may take place. It may highlight items of evidence, for example, you know, a shoe or item of a shirt or something like that that has a unique mark on it that, you know, you may not be looking for. So you may go to a suspect's home and you may conduct a search, but you, if you don't know to look for, you know, the NBA basketball t-shirt that I showed up, you may not collect that piece of evidence thinking that it's not relevant to you. So it does help increase the efficiency, and I want to kind of urge a lot of you here to don't necessarily think as forensic science or forensic tools as just a means of evidence to certify somebody in court or to convict them in court, but to use it as a tool to help your investigation find that person. There are certain disciplines of the forensic arena that you typically won't have that luxury with. But digital forensic evidence is definitely one of those areas in which you need to be consulting with your forensic laboratory or your professional, whoever your department that's doing this kind of work, throughout your investigation, from quite early investigation, so that they can help point the guys out on the field what they're looking for and collect that evidence and bring it in and preserve it, so that when it does reach the court, we can back up the fact that we have the evidence to prove that it is there. Alright, so this is how it increases efficiency. We're talking about saving investigators' time, alright, and focus resources, and obviously being able to stand up and hold up in the court system that will allow us to get a conviction and ultimately not have our investigators move forward a case and when APIs back and forth to do that, it tends to get lost, or the process tends to take a lot longer because, you know, you have to have a lot of communication between all the departments before it actually is done. And by that time, your investigation is maybe already 24 to 48 hours complete already. Capture the